pulls her in.
Yeah. And then the first time he just kind of like basically touches her with it, but doesn't go beyond.
Right.
That.
So for she obviously she's like 8, so she doesn't know. So she's assuming
right.
it's a form of love until the
right.
douchebag decides to take it upon himself to.
That's
when I got to that part, like, I literally cussed at the book, threw the book across the room, and it was like, I'm done. I can't. I can't.
Yeah, it was definitely difficult to watch, for sure. No words for that. It was definitely a hard scene to read. And, you know, I finally, after reading the first scene, I'm like, okay, well, I mean, it was still bad, but
I think at this point he has raped her, knocked her out, or something like that, and then she's like sick, like physically sick. So
that's right.
She's already had
hit her out.
Yeah, she's hid her underwear underneath her mattress. Her brother's asking her what's wrong. Her mom is asking her what's wrong. I don't know what happened. Something moved, or maybe she was moving the sheets or something, and that's when
it fell
saw
out
it.
Or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And she saw it. Jamie
yeah.
said, I was glad she described it like that, as hard as it was, because she did like the attention at first and felt loved. Yeah. It was kind of this odd intimacy and this love and being embraced, because you don't really hear about that from
right.
their grandmother and their uncle. Like, you don't hear of them giving them hugs or just showing them love. Honestly, I think in the book, to my looking back at it, from what I can recall, I don't think that they really showed them that type of love until graduation, when
right.
they bought the watches and just kind of like,
mm-hmm.
I'm proud of you moment. But
mm-hmm.
other than that, in the book, it just felt like it was like, do this, make sure you're doing this in the store, and clean up your room, and do your chore, and then make sure you're back by this time. And
I think her grandmother and her uncle showed them a different kind of love. So, I don't know if you ever read the book, 5 Love Languages.
Yes.
Maya seemed to me, came across to me as one of those, it was a physical touch, like she needed that, right?
Yeah.
Not
yeah.
the way Freeman gave it to her, but she needed that. Her
right.
grandmother and her uncle, all those people, they gave her more of a, like they gave her attention and everything, but it was more of a structure in life. So
right.
to them, they were loving her. This is how we're going to raise her, you know, we'll teach her the right things, you know, stuff like that. So that was different for her, and that's what
yeah.
the physical touch of love is what she needed, not what Freeman gave her, but you know,
right, so. Yeah, which is why she felt so comforted
right.
by it at first.
Mm-hmm.
But I was glad that he was actually caught, you know, for what he did, and I was actually kind of surprised at the mom and her reaction, and the fact that like she was pissed off, you know what I mean, and
yeah.
did something about it, because a lot of times when you see situations like that, the mom will do anything to keep the man, or so head over heels in love, that
taught that. And she was super young, so you don't know what love is. An adult is giving you affection like that. Like, it's different, I guess you can say. But when he, like, literally forced himself on her and knocked her out and all that, he got aggressive. So that,
yeah.
I understood why she said that and why she did that.
Right. She was scared, you know?
Mm-hmm.
She was scared for her life. I see Shoshana. Welcome. She's on the Facebook side of the chat. Looking at things. If you guys can get on Instagram, you can see Anna. I know you'll be able to hear her, but you can actually see her face. So you can go to my Instagram, book_girl_magic, and you can see Anna's face on the other chat. Yeah, that part was absolutely heartbreaking. And so from that point on, they're sent back to their grandparents, to Stamps.
Right.
And that, did she become mute when she got back to Stamps or before that point?
Probably at that point. Basically when she found out that Freeman came to the house and said that he was beat up. She stopped speaking, and I felt like the reason, not only out of fear and shock, is because somebody told her Freeman died, and the reason Freeman died is because she, I don't want to say ratted him out, but she told the truth of what he did. So that fear of her voice, because I don't think Maya was very vocal, but I think the fear of what her voice could do,
the power
shut her
to
down.
Kill,
yeah.
Right.
Shut her down, and she didn't talk for like 6 years or something like that.
That's insane. Except for Bailey.
Except for Bailey. But even with Bailey, it was just occasional. It wasn't just like, you know, full blown conversation. So that was very interesting.
And then, you know, Mama, which is their grandmother, that's what they called her, introduces Maya to Bertha Flowers. Who is the kind, educated woman, and she gives Maya these books to read, which kind of, I mean, Maya already had a love for books and things like that before then, but it was, she got her to read out loud, which, you know, giving her books of poetry that helped her regain her voice. So I thought that was really cool that she had someone that could help her have a voice again.
I think, Ms. Flowers said that poetry is the music of the voice, and I think she was getting on Maya about reading and stuff, and she was like, you gotta speak it, and Maya was upset because she didn't want to. She would like write it down, and she's like, no, I'm not with that, so I want you to talk.
You
so
say it out loud.
I appreciate her doing that. She found a way, like a therapeutic way, for Maya to gain her voice again. So at the end of the day, Maya left her voice, but her voice never left her.
Jamie said she spoke of that in an interview. She was scared of the power of her words because they had killed a man. But yeah, if you can find that interview too, Jamie, that would be awesome to post in the group or on this, you know, send it to me so that I can post it. That would be great. I didn't know that this was a movie until Anna sent me the link today. I thought that was very cool. I'm like, now against white hypocrisy through his sermon on charity. The spiritual strength gained during the sermon soon dissipates as the revival crowd walks home past the honky-tonk party. So that's like when they found that body, that dead body, and the white man was celebrating the fact that there was this dead body. And also the community coming together and listening to Joe Lewis. I felt like that was such a awesome part to read, just how they came together and they were so excited. And it was like Joe Lewis at the time was the hope of conquering the white man. Mm-hmm. And so everybody was like just rooting for him, longing for him to defend his title against his white opponent. So, but yeah, there's so many different incidents that happened to her as a little girl during that time that do teach her about racism. I think one of the most hurtful parts for me was when she had that toothache. And her grandmother was like, oh, let's just go into town. I have this dentist that I've earned money, which black people are amazing to me. Like, honestly, we are so forgiving, even after all that we've been through, the fact that, like, this white man who's a dentist needed money to kind of keep his family afloat. You take your hard-earned money and your earnings and you let this man borrow some money. And then you go to the dentist thinking, oh, he owes me a favor. Like, I've helped him out. You know, no problem. He's going to help me out. And it's like, she walks into the dentist and he's like, I'd rather put my hand in a dog's mouth than put my hand in your black granddaughter's mouth. And that just, it shattered me. Like, and I loved how Maya kind of came up with her own reenactment of what happened in that story. And she was like, oh, yeah, she went in there and told Mom and told him to leave town and all of this other stuff. And in her mind, she built up this whole entire story that
it worked for her.
Right, with Mom. And she, and then it kind of was like, well, I don't know if that really happened, but in my mind, that's what happened. You know? She's like, Mama's not going to let him get away with that nonsense. I appreciated that. And just seeing her perspective in general during that time frame of all the things that they had to deal with. I mean, her grandmother was a pretty powerful person, not only in the black community, but for a white man to go out of his way to borrow money from a black woman, like, she had some power and some influence.
Yeah, I thought she had, like, the store. It was the only black store, black-owned store in that community. So,
I loved hearing the stories of Maya and Bailey where they would steal candy and pickles and do it discreet. Like, I really wonder, because, you know, adults sometimes will just let kids get away with stuff. Like, in their mind, they're like, oh, yeah, we got away with it all the time. We'd steal pickles, candy.
Yeah.
And no one would ever know. And I'm like, okay, as a kid, I know I wasn't that careful. Like, I know that you leave wrappers and evidence and stuff like that. So I'm like, did y'all really get away with this? Or was it something that Mom was just kind of like, let kids be kids.
Kids, right. Right.
Yeah. But then a part of me also, as strict as she was, I'm like, her and the uncle probably take out a belt if they found out that they're stealing from their store. You know, their profit, too.
Right.
Back in the day, it's not easy to get the candy and the supplies and the you know, things that, you know, you needed. So, too. And also, like, I was reading this summary to refresh my memory, but it also didn't talk about, which was a significant part for Bailey, two scenes for me, was seeing his mother, or this lady that looked like his mother at the movie theater, which caused him to come home super late.
Right.
And then he was just kind of depressed. After that, not having their mother around. And then the other thing was Bailey, when he had that
stories like in 4 books, if I'm not mistaken.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm. So there's like 3 other ones that pertain
to
her life. To
know what happened, yeah. Because it ends at her being 15, 16 and being pregnant. So for me,
yeah.
It's kind of like cliffhanger, like what happened next, you know? Mm-hmm. With this new, which was interesting to me that she was just kind of hit some rando off the street and was like, let's go do this. It's like that one time. Which all it takes, but it's like that one time you get knocked up. But then she finally kind of felt like
priority, but like what I own, I'm just kind of random. Like right now, I just started this one just because.
Nice.
Before we were
yours. Was that mine?
Just a random whatever. Let's see.
Yeah.
Kinda.
Comments that Jessica said she read The Land. But I think Merlene Reeves had a great suggestion that I saw on Instagram. I was just kind of going, she's on a hiatus, but I was kind of going through her post and saw that she had made
show you. Gotta turn on some light here. You guys a house?
Yeah. Unexpected.
I mean, I know you got but I had a closet that had.
Oh, that is freaking awesome.
Yeah, so what I've done is I'm trying to separate books that I've read, put those up here, and books that, I
would. Where? Oh.
Girl, I trashed that book.
Oh, never mind. I thought that was red and white one.
No. And then what I'm trying to do is just organize, like, trying to do two shelves of books that I will read with between January and March. It's pretty bad, guys. I'm not even kidding. And I'm not even requesting that much anymore, so it's like, what is this to do?
And see, my dilemma is, I don't watch DVDs anymore, and I actually don't buy them anymore because they end up being on TV or whatever, or digital.
Uh-huh.
But I have, like, hundreds of DVDs that are in my spare bedroom. But those are going to have to be moved as I'm moving kids around into their bedrooms. Like, those are going to have to come out. So what you did with your closet space with books is what I'm going to have to do with DVDs.
Mm.
My next house is going to have a basement, an office that has, like, wall-to-wall bookshelves because this is just, it's out of hand. And I've already donated, the crazy part is I've already donated a lot of books.
I did the same. What do you do with your arts? I have tons of art. So I was like, some I haven't read, some I have read. I was like, is there any value to them? How much of the book has changed since, you know, the final copies?
So right,
like,
there.
Do I hold on to it and read it anyway? So
yeah. And I do have duplicates of some of my books, just that I'm running out of space on my wall of shelves. Yeah, that's, I have a lot of publishers that they send us stuff, it's like, oh, now this book is out of paperback, but I'm like, oh, well, I have the ARC, do I need this one too, because it's the final, you know what I mean? So
right.
I just keep, like, I don't need that book again, like, I just, I don't need it, but what I'm thinking for sure, read our book club picks. I will put you in a giveaway, which will be pretty freaking awesome. But our our January book of the month is More Than Enough by Elaine Welteroth. I'm excited to read this. I've heard nothing but great things from everybody that's read it so far. Sucks because I don't read my books until the end of the month so that I can discuss it or remember what's going on.
If you read that one now, you would. It's one you won't forget.
Yeah, that's all I'm going to say. It's really, really good. So,
yeah. She's about to talk about
it. Right now, I'm trying to finish Children of Virtue and Vengeance. I'll leave it at that. I'm not that it's, like, horrible, but I'm just, it hasn't caught me yet where I'm, like, oh my, you know, fully invested like I was in the first one. I don't know. It could just be me, but I'm slowly trucking through it. So I'm listening to that, and then when And it was $30.
The publisher sent me that one. They sent me a final copy, but yeah.
I was about to say,
it was, if I paid for it, it would have been worth every penny. That book is amazing.
Books by the Cup said, Anna knows my story about they were her property.
Yeah.
Mine is Sunday. Oh, you're a Capricorn. Yeah, my ex-husband is one too. Sorry for you. His birthday is tomorrow. Basketball practice, and we were supposed to have practice yesterday, which is why I scheduled this today, and they moved practice to today, and I was like, this is messing up my plans, like,
right.
Hey, the sports are messing up my life here, and so I was like, listen, you've got to, I'll drop them off at practice at 7 o'clock, but you either got to keep them with you till 9 o'clock, because I cannot be disturbed, or you have to figure something else, so he's like, oh, I'll keep them up overnight.
Just my takeaway from the book that it just taught you. I feel like Maya taught us how the black girls have value and to learn to forgive, because having that burden on your shoulders can really weigh things down for you. So I mean, at the overall, that's my takeaway of the book.
Yeah, I loved it.